You coming, and hopefully what we can talk to you about today hopefully will be of interest. And do please ask questions along the way if either you can't hear us or it's not clear what we're talking about. So do stop us if you want to make comments as we go. I'm Timothy Barrett, and I'm a children's doctor based at Birmingham Children's Hospital, and I lead the children's bit of the Wolfram Service, and my colleague Professor Karen Morrison, who's here as well, is the adult part. So for this, I'm going to talk a little bit about what we're trying to do with developing services. And I'll introduce you to people who are here from the service as we go along as well. And when we get to the research bit later, I'll introduce you to the researchers that we've got here. So it's really nice to have so many people from Birmingham coming to the meeting as well. So just to explain, first of all, as you know, all pay your taxes. I'm sure you all pay your taxes. I'm sure you do. And that pays for the National Health Service. And the National Health Service pays for general practitioners and GPs who you go to every week or so for coughs or colds or basic problems. If you use hospitals, hospitals are paid by the National Health Service NHS England, and that pays for Birmingham Children's Hospital and all the other ones around the country. There is a group at the very top called Highly Specialised Services, which is funded at the top by NHS England. And they're about 70 of them, and they're to look after some very expensive treatments that perhaps have to be rationed, or for some particular rare diseases. And we've been fortunate enough to get Wolfram syndrome included in those highly specialised services, paid for by the government as part of this service, as part of this. We applied in 2010 and got some money from the summer 2012 to try and set up a specialist service for Wolfram and the Queen Elizabeth Hospital site, led by Karen Morrison here, and on the Children's Hospital site, led by myself. With the philosophy, the idea is that we wanted to try and coordinate care for young people and adults better than was done before, if we could, in one place once a year, and try and develop expertise with doctors who could understand the condition better, and to try and address not just the medical problems, but also try and provide support for education, social things, transition things, employment, for people who are going to have need support through their lives. And we set it up with four children's clinics a year, three adult clinics, and one joint adult transition clinic for young people moving to the adult service. So that's what we were paid for to start. It was a partnership between the Children's Hospital, which is in a big old Victorian building in the centre of Birmingham, a brand spanking new Queen Elizabeth Hospital in Edgbaston, which is a super setup, fantastic, and wonderful support from the Well Child Children's Charity, who've been absolutely fantastic throughout this, a national charity for children, looking after children with complex things as well. And since then, we've also had support from the genetics laboratory to develop genetics testing. And of course now, with Wolfram Syndrome UK, have developed and co-partnering, organising this meeting, which is absolutely wonderful. What we try to do then, with these services, is to try and contact your local doctors to provide them with some support about how to give you care plans locally. If you're using blind colleges or Sense or an RNAV, support again as to how to keep you well, and also with the local doctors as well. And now, most recently, with Marie McGee and others, education services, trying to talk to schools to explain to them what the condition is and how to look after. And the overall model, as you know, is to try and provide a one-stop shop, either for adults or for children, just on a once-a-year basis, to see young people, to advise about riders, genetics and counselling, psychology, and other different aspects. And on the adult side for neurology and psychiatry and various other parts as well. It's not to take over local care, but just to try and provide advice for local doctors and local teams to support you that way. So the people that are now looking after this is, for the clinic coordinators, Leslie Porter and Lindsay Wilson, and some of the staff are here, which is great. Marie McGee is here. Can you stand up, Marie, just to introduce you? Fantastic. Marie, thank you ever so much for coming. Marie's come along and she's been a real asset because she's been helping young people moving from the children's to the adult services, but not just the clinical bit, but also advice about education, further education and employment issues and things as well. It's been great. Susan Gleason is our children's diabetes nurse. Susan, can you stand up please? Fantastic. Susan is our children's diabetes nurse and is doing a great job building up expertise about managing diabetes with sight limiting conditions and how to support that, which is grand. I do these with my colleague Dr. Melanie Kershaw. Dr. Raj Gupta, who sadly is unable to be here because his son's not been very well, so he can't be here today. Liam McCarthy, the urology doctor, and I'm very sorry that he's not here because he's had to do an emergency theatre list. He's been on call this week and he's been called in, so I'm very sorry about that. But Denise Williams, I'm sure I spotted Denise. Denise, will you stand up? Denise Williams, genetics doctor, absolutely fantastic. Denise and I go back a long way because we were both researchers together about 15 years ago or so. And Denise has got a long-standing interest in patients with warfarin. I'm very grateful for you coming as well. And then on here I've got Archana Kulkarni. Archana, can you stand up? Archana is our ophthalmology consultant working with John Ainsworth, who started doing warfarin clinics at the Children's for the last 6 months or so. And Prasad, who's got an expertise. Actually, Prasad, can you stand up as well? Prasad's joining us. He's got an expertise in vision aids and sight aids. And one area of development, maybe that we'll be able to talk about in a minute, is how to try and support you more with sight aids. Yeah. Thank you, Prasad. And then Claire Passage, Claire then, I'm sure saw Claire at the back. Claire, will you stand up as well? Claire's here as well, and she's, thank you very much for coming. Advice about psychology issues and family issues and things as well, and trying to understand those better in this condition. And then from the research side, Catherine Landon, who's not here today, but others are. And then Rachel, you've already met, supporting as a family liaison officer. Karen Morrison, I'm going to hand over to in a moment, talking about the adult service. So I think that's most of the people. Have I missed anybody out? No, that's good, otherwise that would be very embarrassing. You know about the timetable, coming to the hotel the day before and then having a series of appointments on the day. This just shows the activity, which I thought might be interesting. We started from the summer of 2010 with about 18 people coming to clinics at that stage, all new to the service then. And we've had a steady number of new referrals of between 2 and 4 each year since then. We had 24 clinic slots so far this year, and we've got 32 children booked into the service altogether. And the number of young people we've seen is more than that. It's probably near about 36 or 37. But some of the young people have moved up to the adult service, and then we've had new people coming. So it's probably about 3/4 of the young people in the country, something like that. So that maybe there's about 40 to 45 young people altogether. But that's the sort of numbers that we see. And then some young people have also come from abroad, from Malta and Sardinia as well, which has been really nice to sort of see people from elsewhere. We have to get the grant from the NHS, we have to demonstrate that the services is delivering what you need it to. So your feedback's really important. And if there are things that you'd like to see, we do need you to tell us that and support. Because the government sets out that we have to try and improve quality of life, help people get better from episodes of ill health, have a positive experience of care, make sure that we don't lose people early, and then treating people in a safe way and trying to avoid harm through the hospital services. And all that we have to do is get judged against that. So the performance indicators we've said that we would do, we said that we would try and screen everybody for diabetes insipidus every couple of years. So that's built into the clinics now, both on the adult and the children's side. Try and develop guidelines for patient management. And with our American, Japanese, French and European colleagues, we've put together some guidelines which we're trying to send out to your local doctors. Trying to screen every child over 15 for neurological problems, and Dr. Raj Gupta's been doing that, including using MRI brain scans. I think we're finding now that with the MRI brain scans, we've got baseline data, but a number of people are feeding back saying that's very tiring and taking a long time to do. And maybe we're looking next year at perhaps just doing that as a baseline and then just doing it every 5 years rather than every year, because I know that some young people find that quite hard. And hopefully that we won't get so many delays in diagnosis. We've got to try and show that the age of diagnosis of people when they're referred gets less as the condition gets better recognised. And all the fantastic work that Wolfenstein UK have done with their road trip, giving packs to all the hospitals around the country, and they're going to be doing, Tracy will be talking about the GPs, hopefully will make it young people be diagnosed much earlier than later in the future, and that will really help. And then development of family outcome and patient experience tools, and we've got support from WellChild and the School of Education in Birmingham who are involved in that. So there is a guideline now, it's got to version 5, it's actually got to version 14, this is an old one now, which we've put together and went out in the information packs to all the hospitals in the country, and that we're trying to send out to you and your local doctors. If you want to copy yourselves, then you can let us know through the clinic coordinator and we can post those out to you to give to your local doctors as well. And it's as far as we can work out between Karen, myself, Fumi and all the experts in Washington University Hospital, hospitals in France and abroad, at the moment, the state of the art knowledge as to how to keep people healthy with Wolfram. That's what we're trying to do with those. We've had feedback from you that we've tried to address. Finding the clinics tiring, wanting to get to know the adult hospital before transfer, and visiting the Queen Elizabeth. And Marie's helped tremendously with visiting the Queen Elizabeth Hospital to go. We've also tried to spread the appointments out, and we've also tried to create a space at the Children's Hospital, brighter ward areas that we've got there, and also a chill-out room with the clinic. And if those of you that come to the Children's Clinic next year, hopefully you'll see that we've got a pod now, as it's an area where there's going to be music played, there's going to be activities, and an area that's free, doctors are not allowed in. So when you're there, you know you're safe. There's no doctors coming and attacking, which will help.